Okay, thank you. So today's topic is going to be related to the expanding powers of law enforcement, at least the proposed expanding powers. We see this in different areas. We see it in the case of PRISM. We see it in the Netherlands with a new proposed law which greatly expands the powers of law enforcement to observe and to interfere with people's digital activities. Okay, so we're going to be talking about that, and for this, I'm going to be the moderator. My name is Herbert Bos. I'm from the VU University Amsterdam. The panelists that we have, it's a small panel, is on the far left, on your side, the far left, Rejo Zengers. He's a privacy advocate, works for Bits of Freedom, and he cares about digital rights and internet freedom and these sorts of things. And on your right, we have Merel Koning, who's a PhD researcher at Radboud University in Nijmegen. She's published on this topic in the past, even before these proposed laws were written. She wrote a thesis that was all about whether hacking should be permitted as an investigative method. And she's written some articles on this later also. So these are your panelists, and just to give you an idea of where we are, because there's some people from, not from the Netherlands. There's also people from the Netherlands who may not have all the details of this new proposed law. I would like to ask first, how many of you have heard of this this proposed law in the Netherlands that that gives greatly expands the powers? Great. So how many of you have read the memo of an explanation that goes with it? So that's much fewer. Maybe we get more people if we ask how many of you know basically the four major items in this this proposed law, right? So this is this proposed amendment. Okay, so that's relatively few. So before we start, I would like to very briefly, without going into details, remind you what this is, what this new expanded powers for law enforcement might be. So the first is a very controversial one, perhaps even the most controversial one, and that is hacking. Hacking, by the government, by law enforcement, for instance, to observe or to install software bugs on someone's machine, or to remove material from someone's machine, or to install executables on someone's machine for investigative purposes, for instance. Okay, the crime is serious enough. This should be possible in the near future, according to this proposal. The second one is, making it impossible to access certain material that is available online. So, making it impossible to access certain material can mean many things. It can just mean, take down a server. It could also mean that you physically interfere in someone's machine and remove that material. Even you can actually do this remotely also. The third main item in this proposal is what is known as a decryption order. So a suspect in a crime, a serious crime, can be ordered to give up the decryption key of material that is encrypted on storage devices that he controls, okay. And the last one is a law that makes it illegal, punishable to handle material that was obtained from breaking in somebody's machine, getting the material, publishing it online, doing some other things with it. That handling is punishable by law. So those are the four main items within these proposals. And before I start filling up the time altogether, I would like to give the two panelists, say, 2 minutes to comment on these four items in this entire set of proposals in general terms, in just 2 minutes. And I would like to start with ladies first, I guess.
Okay.
Merel.
So there are four topics, and I looked into hacking by the police, and I did some research on a case, the Bredolab botnet. And now there's the proposal, and the proposal for hacking by the police or remote access. I think the scope is too broad, and they sell the authority or the proposal as something for severe cases of cybercrime, but it goes for almost all types of crime in the Netherlands, and I think that's off limits. The interference with privacy of the suspect cannot be proportionate under all circumstances. The other thing that I dislike about the proposal is the fact how they handled territoriality. This is a legal aspect. I'm a lawyer. And the way they deal with it is say, okay, this principle doesn't go very well online, so let's just not deal with it at all. And from a legal perspective, that's very dangerous. We might go into that later. But for certain cases of severe cybercrime, I think there should be some type of authority for police, for the police to actually hack into people's computer. So I'm slight on the positive side of the idea, but the way it is laid down now in the proposal, I'm against it.
Okay, 2 minutes.
Thank you. Well, for me, I would say I agree with some of the critical points of Merel, but also you already mentioned, like, in having the Dutch police hacking on computers in other countries. For me, that's really unacceptable, because this means that, for example, the Germans or the French in this room, they possibly have next year the Dutch police on their computers while they are in Germany working on something, but the Dutch police has the ability to hack on that computer. That works the other way around as well. So other governments, which maybe have different ethical values, for example, will do the same to us, which I think is a bad thing as well. Another thing would be is that definition for a computer is fairly broad, which means that if the government is talking about hacking computers, then everybody thinks of like a laptop or a PC. But the definition is very, very broad, which means a computer could also mean a hearing aid or a computer in a car. We are living in a digitizing world where everything is getting more and more connected. The Internet of Things, everybody knows about. And the more we go in that direction, the more computers the police can hack into. Another thing is that I think that there is lacking a lot of oversight when the police would use these types of powers. The oversight that is proposed now is more or less the same as those for wiretapping in the Netherlands. And if I tell you that the Dutch are kings in wiretapping, they are doing more wiretapping than the United States, for example, then you can ask yourself questions about whether it's enough. I'm doing at Bits of Freedom a lot of FOIA requests and trying to get transparency on how the powers are used by the police. And it's very, very difficult to get details about it. So if you look at stealth SMS or IMC catchers, we don't know how often the police is using those. And this will happen the same to the use of, for example, spyware. My 2 minutes are gone.
Well, yes,
too
yes,
bad.
Long gone. Okay, so now we've basically set the scene to some extent. This entire hour is actually meant for discussion. So I would very much welcome people to come up to the microphone, give their points of view, but hold on. And you know, so maybe probe this a little bit. It would be very good if we hear some, you know, rabid proponents, people who are very in favor of this kind of measures. And just to start off, to warm up the audience, I would like to start with a question for Rejo. And the question is this, right? So this is a proposal that's been, you know, a couple of months in coming. And now we've seen it appear in May, right? So, and it has these far-reaching abilities, and it's very intrusive. You know, the measures are, you know, they're not mild, right? So, and still, the amount of commotion has been very modest, right? It's been quiet, and fairly quiet in the papers. So, what has Bits of Freedom been doing?
Good question. We have been opposing this proposal, of course. The proposal has been put into consultation, which means that anyone who is interested can put forward their objections. So we did write a lengthy explanation of our problems with this proposal. But we also try to explain this to normal people who are not legally very into this matter. So we wrote a lot of blogs, for example, explaining what is actually being said in this proposed law, and of course there will be a lot more campaigning to come.
Thank you. So, a question for Merel then. There are a number of issues with the proposal because it is really intrusive into the lives of ordinary citizens. And very few people would really like to have their computer hacked by governments or, you know, outsiders for that matter. The question is it necessary? Are there alternatives? So in the proposal, the minister writes that, you know, nowadays with advances in technology, criminals no longer access the internet necessarily from their homes, so it's very hard to monitor at a central access point of that criminal. Everything is encrypted, so, you know, even if you do intercept all the traffic, you know, you can't really decrypt it anymore. They don't store necessarily all the material at their home PCs anymore. They store it in the cloud. Is there an alternative to doing it this way?
For many things that they want to accomplish with this new proposal, there are alternatives like wiretapping and other investigative methods, but from my point of view and what I've been reading about it and been hearing about it, there are certain types where it's very difficult to figure out who is responsible or how to stop certain types of, especially cyber crime. For example, botnets. You just mentioned that you were looking into a botnet with the university, and now, a couple of months later, it's becoming harder to track that same botnet because the technological development is so fast. I think for those types of crime, certain extensive powers for law enforcement, or perhaps it shouldn't be law enforcement, but other organizations are wanted in society, or necessary in society, at least.
Okay, one second. So just to clarify this one comment, yeah, come up to the microphone if you have a question. To clarify the comment, so what my role as a university researcher is that we're somewhat on the receiving end of this kind of legislation. So we are busy, we have been busy for many months in tracking certain complicated, advanced botnets, peer-to-peer-based botnets like the peer-to-peer-based Zeus, and trying to take them down, right? So what we found there is one thing that is somewhat worrying, is that we think by now we reached the point where these advanced botnets cannot be taken down with conventional means. Conventional means sinkholing, you know, no interference into these things. So this is it's a data point. I'm not saying that this is a good cause for hacking government. It's just a data point. And one of the other things that we ran into is that we actually found, you know, data. You know, we could have found data. We didn't look into that at all, but we actually are worried about, you know, the extent to which we can actually look into the stuff that's going on in this botnet. Okay, we think it's interesting from a research perspective, but we don't touch it because there are no legislative rules for this that we can apply to. I just want to give the floor briefly to Rejo because he had a comment on that, and after that it's your question.
Because I want to add, like in for the decryption order, I think there is no justification for its necessity. We've been doing at Bits of Freedom lots of FOIA requests, so we've asked the government, please show us documents which prove there's really a problem with the encrypted files on the system. And the only answer we got from the police was, there are no documents. And the only answer we got from the prosecution was, there's no documents about this. So this means that either there is no problem or it's not documented. And in both cases, I don't think that's enough to justify such a decryption order.
Yeah, I agree on that one.
I fully agree with you on the decryption order. It's very much against the Nemo Teneto beginsel, to say it in Dutch, to not cooperate with your own incrimination. But about the hacking, I have a question. What are the circumstances under which someone can be hacked from a law enforcement point of view? Because you have to have a reasonable suspicion to begin with, mm-hmm. not deriving from hacking, because you can only do that after you have some kind of permission from the rechtercommissaris. Mm-hmm. So how is that being tackled in the
This is a question for which panel? Merel?
Merel, yes.
From the top of my head, I have the proposal there. But so there should be suspicion and to a certain level, and there should be dringende noodzaak. So there should be an urgent cause.
Yeah. Pressing need. Yep.
Yeah, pressing need. As well as the general conditions under which law enforcement can deploy certain methods of proportionality and subsidiarity. So they shouldn't go further as they should have to go. And if there are less restrictive means to achieve the same goal and the same outcome, they should use that.
So wouldn't there be a kind of a test by a judge before yes. a permission is being given?
So law enforcement should go to the public prosecutor, and they have to ask the investigating judge, and he has to send that to a commission, and the commission will look into the certain to the specific case. And the commission, as well as the public prosecutor, as well as the investigative judge, need to assess the proportionality and the subsidiarity and all the other tick boxes for so deploying
this method. After
that,
when the court case is there, there's another judge, no?
Mm-hmm. Well. Yeah, and I think that's one of the problematic things in this proposal. Eventually, the commission and the investigative judge is not giving insight in the methods of hacking. So it's just, we are going to hack this and this suspect for this and this reason, and we want to find, or we think we can find this and this. But the way they do it, it's all secretive, because otherwise they could give criminals an advantage if they give out their methods. That's the reason behind it. So that's not being given in this order. So the judges, in the end, cannot assess whether the proportionality and subsidiarity is actually being taken into account in that certain case. So there's a difficulty and two sides to it. On the one way, they don't want to give out their methods. On the other hand, we want transparency to see what is happening. So that's very problematic in this proposal.
Does this answer your question?
Yes.
And do you have any comment?
Also, I think it's a misunderstanding that everything that the police does will be judged in the end.
Yes.
Because when there's an investigation done, maybe the police thinks at some point, okay, it doesn't lead anywhere, we drop the case and that's it. Then maybe those powers are used, but they're not judged by a court. The same goes for, you have, so these powers are used to come to a, to justify a suspicion, to mm-hmm. say someone, you are guilty. But to prove that the person is guilty, you can get away with only showing some of the powers that that have been used. So it's not necessary that all the powers that have been used are explained to the judge. And this does actually happen. There's a uitspraak. There's a uitspraak.
Court case. Verdict.
A verdict, yeah. There's a verdict on a case this summer where the police was using stealth SMS. And they didn't tell the court about it, but because the lawyers were asking about it, then it turned out stealth SMS was being used. And I presume the same will happen to the use of, for example, spyware, because police does not want to have this judged. They want to keep it to themselves. They want to be very secretive about it. So I think it's a general misunderstanding that everything the police does
but
will be
stealth SMS. Did they got investigative judge on that? Did they? Was it the same procedure followed? Because this is a written procedure that they have to follow, and it's in the case.
Nice, you're asking this because
yeah,
because it's funny. There was a stealth SMS is something which is not really regulated in the Netherlands. There's no law which allows the use of stealth SMS. So this is done by some more generic provision by law, and the police has its own setup, has its own rules on how to use this this power. One of these rules in this policy is they have to write it down to describe what they have done. So to use it in a court room, for example. But in this verdict, it showed police did not adhere to their own rules. So they did not write down what they needed, what they were requiring themselves to write down. So even if, I don't think that's enough anyway. So I don't mm-hmm. think it will work.
All right, thank you very much.
I have an opinion on the topic of this panel, and I'll try to be brief. Allowing states giving them hacking capabilities actually makes the internet less secure than more secure. You're incentivizing them to research vulnerabilities, which is good, but instead of fixing them, they're going to write exploits, they're going to weaponize them. They're going to make the internet less secure than more secure, which even creates a spiral, because if they don't fix vulnerabilities that they know about, many internet users are affected by those, which also the criminals know and use it to grow their botnets, which actually creates more cybercrime than less cybercrime. Also, it incentivizes the million-dollar market that already exists in vulnerabilities, pushing even more money into it, getting even more people to, instead of doing responsible disclosure or in-doubt full disclosure, write an exploit and sell it to a shady government. You've mentioned that other countries are supposed to be hacks. Well, then they want that capability too, and we're going to have an international, I don't know, I don't want to use the term of cyber war, but if all the governments engage in hacking other people's computers, what the fuck is this? even if you did get into the point of, oh yeah, we need this tightly regulated and only for the real terrorist stuff, it's not going to work, because when you intrude a computer, when you own it, you cannot use any evidence on there in court, because you have no proof that it hasn't been tampered with. The Dutch law already also says you're allowed to delete files. Well, I've seen many times in court cases that files were deleted, which could have helped the defendant. Also, they are not controllable. We got a state Trojan in Germany, we dissected it, and we found out it did way more than legally allowed. And that will happen with every single one of state Trojan. If you allow states to have their capability, well, we're the democratic countries. What are the authoritarian regimes going to say? They're going to have a field day. Hey, you're doing it, so we want to have this too. You'll open up Pandora's box. You'll make the situation worse for everyone. So should states have hacking capabilities? Hell no. There are ways to fix that.
Well done.
I have one more.
Okay, one more then.
Shall we
there are ways around this. If you know, if you want to own a box, you know it's IP. You know who's legally responsible then. Get a court order, take down the box, do forensics on it. It's been happening for years.
Exactly.
Thank you. So just summarizing, I think there were four main points. So I don't know whether I remember all of them, but one of them is it will actually increase the market for exploits, and you know there will be more selling of those exploits to governments and perhaps shady regimes, right? That was another point. Any comments on this, Merel? Because I think you were in favor of that anyway.
Yep. Certainly, the moment there's more demand to sell exploits, it's more interesting to do that. At this moment, there's already a huge demand by other cyber criminals and by secret services. So this market is already there. And that's it. It will be for some criminals or for some people who discover an exploit, it will be an incentive and try to sell them. These different incentives and these different objectives to law enforcement, that's always going to be there. Just like securing your house is very good not to be not to get burglary, but if they want to do an inside, or I don't know the English word, observe the house from the inside and they have a court order, it's harder to get in. So these two things are always there, and it's a valid point.
So there's actually something that just occurred to me is this is all about, you know, trying to track a suspect and observe and you know, I don't know, for investigative purposes. Does it make any difference if it's about a botnet causing a lot of damage, financial damage, or I don't know, other sorts of damage? Would that be more permissible for Bits of Freedom, for instance, to try and take that down? Is that a different case or is that the same case?
No, I think it's the same case because we're talking about a power which is uncontrollable. Just well explained. It is uncontrollable. So I don't think you need, whatever the reason, you would want to have a tool in the hands of the police which is uncontrollable. So no, I don't think that makes a difference.
Very clear. Next question.
I think we can all agree that this proposal is disproportionate, but I think it's also unnecessary because you can already now know where traffic is coming from and where traffic is going to if you own the ISP or you give a court order to the ISP. Second, you can read the raw messages being sent and received. The thing about hacking is not that you can force the computer to do nothing, because if you want to shut it down, you can just pull the internet connection. But you need to hack it if you want to make it do something specific, like decrypting some message or giving messages to other systems. And if it is indeed a botnet controller, then you may be able to hack this system, then give messages to the controlled botnet computers to shut the application down. But then these systems would still be compromised and the owners would never know.
Okay, good point. So the main point, I guess, so far was that you don't need this because we already have the means to obtain the traffic and legislate and do things at the ISP level, right? So the proposal, actually, does any of you want to comment? The proposed law actually mentions this as a problem. Any of you want to comment on this?
Yeah, I'm a lawyer. I think you're the person that knows most about the technical specifics and whether or not in that sense it's necessary.
So the only thing I can say is that the proposal says this will no longer do. Right, because the attacker is no longer just connecting from a single place. He will take his laptop and move to, you know, some I don't know, camping ground in north of Holland, or you know, some other open access where he can access his botnet or you know whatever he does and start his criminal activities from there. Not only that, even if we could intercept all of that, it will be heavily encrypted. We cannot access it. It will be stored in a cloud that we don't have the keys for. So, hence the proposal says we should be able to do this on the attacker's machine, because then we have access to the keys, we have access to you know wherever that attacker connects from.
Making things that things are becoming becoming more difficult doesn't mean other powers are necessary. So I still don't see a reason for having these powers around just because of that.
Okay, I'm not surprised.
I was wondering, I had a question about the decryption orders. Is that also a relevant subject for now? Or
Yes, absolutely. Right. Yes, it's the full breadth of the proposals, yes.
All right, so I was wondering, I'm not sure if anyone has heard about plausible deniability, but it's basically a way to technically make it impossible to prove that you've decrypted all your data. So you'd have lots of different... Lots of different partitions, and they'd all have their own key, and they'd be hidden. So you could have several partitions, one with your recipes and one with your confidential data that will prove that the government is doing something bad. And I was wondering, just because right now, with the current proposal, you'd be guilty until proven innocent, which is pretty bad, in my opinion. But would they be able to hold you forever if they would, you know, you decrypted something, but they can't prove there's more? Can you give me something about that? I heard you were a lawyer, so I was wondering if you could tell me something about this.
Sorry, I did. What was your question at the end? I didn't
All right,
hear you.
Sorry. So I was wondering if they, right now, with the current proposal, they could hold you or even put you in jail if you don't decrypt your hard disk.
Yeah.
But I'm working on some software that would make it impossible to prove that you've decrypted everything.
Mm-hmm.
Do you have something to say on that?
So you're talking about hidden containers that even if you decrypted one layer is not going to, you know, find all the other...
Well, you technically really can't prove that there's more or less of them.
Quite.
Well, if they can't prove it, you can't be filed guilty of that certain crime, because that is willingly not cooperating with decrypting. And if you... So if they don't know that something is decrypted, then they cannot order you to decrypt it. So if they don't know about these encrypted containers, you cannot be found guilty.
All right, so let's assume that they know that I could have an infinite amount of partitions.
Mm-hmm.
Could they hold me if I decrypted five of them, if they don't know I have any more? Because now I think you were assuming that they didn't know I had several hidden ones.
Mm-hmm.
But let's assume that they know that I might have more, but they can't prove I have more.
So it
then
shows
under Dutch criminal law, you can't be found guilty.
Thank you very much.
Scary.
Hi, I don't know much about the Dutch proposals. I'm interested in what information they've said that will not be allowed to be published on the internet, because I've been living in Britain for a while, and I come from Australia originally, and like Iceland, they're trying to introduce this concept that the internet will be filtered. You know, they're generally talking about pornography, but as I don't really think the governments give a damn about pornography, they certainly don't care about sexism. They've been dismantling employment rights for women for quite a long time now. My feeling is there's a big move to get us being used to the internet being more regulated, that they want a lot more censorship or control over what's published on the internet, and they're bringing it in through things like pornography, because they feel that people will be too embarrassed to fight against it. If it's just an anti-pornography law, you know, you're obviously just a pervert if you think these laws are bad. So I'm just wondering what is the Netherlands laws about what you're allowed to publish? Have they specified what it is, and is there any feeling about, you know, what they're trying to introduce with that segment of the law?
Yeah. Well, I think I'm not sure whether I understood the question correct, but I'm just going to answer and we'll see if it is the answer to your question. In the Netherlands, you have a number of wars for justifying new proposals. So terrorism is one thing which is always in the justification for a new proposal. The same goes for I hate to say it, but sexual abuse of children, that's always a reason for having completely out of tune proposals. Of course, these are very, very important issues, and we need to think about how to solve these properly. But that also means that we need to make sure we give the police the effective powers and not just powers which give the government an image of being very hard on war, hard on terrorism or whatever, but they need to be really, really helpful. And that's why I think that these proposals are not working.
I think in these proposals, it's also not exactly specified, right? What kind of information they might deem I wouldn't say undesirable, but illegal. Is that right?
Yeah, it's fairly broad. So
that's, it's very broad. That's right. Does that answer your question? I don't know where you've gone to.
I had a question about the discussion just earlier about the decryption order, and I'm not quite sure if I understood the answer. If I have a hidden volume, say I encrypt it, and it's my plans for the world revolution, and there's all sort of things about cooking pans and backpacks on it.
Yes.
And with the other key, I just encrypt my my pictures from OHM2013. Were you saying that if the government suspects I have these plans for world domination, but they can only see my pictures here, I'm going to be found guilty anyway?
That depends. No. Well, guilty of what?
I'm talking about the hidden volume. So you have one encrypted file, but you have two different passwords for it.
Yes.
One password gives you access to the truly incriminating information, and the other password just gives you access to some very innocuous information.
Yeah.
And I thought you were saying, just as an answer to the person before me, that if the government suspects that you still have some information that they haven't gotten their hands on, you can still be found guilty.
That's
because then you'd be getting turtles.
I know, and it's a very difficult answer. I can't give it now. There's some jurisprudence on that, and it's very vague on what's the burden of proof that somebody has information and you know that that person has information and he needs to give it out. Bertjaap Koops, he wrote an advice to the government on this decryption order, and he goes into that in detail. I disagree with him in the end, his conclusions, but that really depends on all circumstances of the case. So that's my answer. I'm not going to say like you are guilty or you're not guilty, because I think the other question was different. It was more that if there's absolutely no proof that there is a encrypted container, can you be found guilty of not giving up your key? And then my answer is no, then you cannot be found guilty. So that's a very clear case, but it's a gray zone. So okay. There's a report written by Bertjaap Koops in which he finally concludes that this decryption order is in line with jurisprudence, or in line with the European Convention of Human Rights, so it doesn't interfere with human rights as long as it meets certain criteria, and he sums them up in the end. And there's an English executive summary, so you can all read it.
Okay, I'm going to look into that.
There is a burden of proof, I think, right? That's the
yes,
summary.
There
is a burden of you have to
prove
that there is
a burden. And that depends from the circumstances of the case.
Can I add one more thing?
But for once, the burden of proof will be then with the government to prove that I'm guilty, I assume.
Guilty of willingly not giving up your key.
Can I add one more thing?
Sure.
Because I think decryption order is a very powerful order. So we should be very careful in having this in law and afterwards in actually using it. The same report Miro was talking about says decryption order doesn't work for the real big criminals, for the hardcore criminals. It only works for the petty thieves, because the hardcore criminals are wise enough to use all kinds of hidden volumes or even volumes which you cannot prove they are hidden. So it will not work against them. So you have a very, very powerful provision in law. You give the police very large powers, but academics say it will not work against the hardcore criminals. It will only work to petty thieves. So I think this is not a good idea as well.
So next question, but I would also like to encourage everybody who is in favor of this proposal to step forward.
Yeah, that's why I'm here, I think. I have a question for Rejo. You've made it clear that you're not in favor of the hacking proposal. You've made it clear that you're not in favor of the decryption proposal. And I'm going to play a devil's advocate here. I see it as the responsibility of the police to safeguard our privacy in the physical world, and maybe also in the digital world. So do you see the police having any role on the net? And if so, what role is that? I was wondering about your opinion.
Well, I think oh, that's a tough question, by the way. I think the police, of course, has a responsibility in making sure the law is being obliged. But I think that, again, it doesn't mean that you should give. I have to yell. Okay. That you should give the police any power just to do so. I still think you need to make a very, you need to think very well about what power do you give the police. What are the risks if you give this power to the police? And if those risks are too big, and especially if those risks are too big for what you're trying to solve, then you shouldn't do it. And one other thing, you said the privacy of people being protected by the police. I always very disappointed by the police in this regard. We've done research with Bits of Freedom last year, and it proves that the Dutch police doesn't really take into account your privacy. All the details they have in their computer systems are not really are not properly looked after. So they're not thrown away after a certain amount of time. There's no really checks on who is being able to access those data. So I'm really, really a bit skeptic about police and your privacy.
Yeah, I was talking about safety, but maybe I mispronounced. But yeah, I think you're definitely right there. Yeah. One more follow-up question. If you were to grant one power to the Dutch police, which one would it be?
None.
Okay, that's clear.
I don't actually have a question, but maybe a cautionary tale of what happens when you hand people superpowers like hacking. So I'm not familiar how many people in the room are familiar. So like in 2012, the German federal police got hacked by the so-called no-name crew. How many people in the room are familiar with that particular case and how that went down? So in 2012, the German federal police got hacked and the German customs. So they had a GPS tracking system called Patras. Mm-hmm. And there's some funny backstory to that particular incident, and it involves. Okay, so anybody aware of that?
I've heard of it.
So what happened was that a father was somewhat concerned about the choice of partners of his daughters, and what he did, he was an officer of the German Federal Police. He had access to a Trojan that the German Federal Police had used in other cases. He installed that on his daughter's computer. And due to that, the friend of the daughter figured this out and used it as a back channel into daddy's computer and into the work network. And this is what can happen. This is the one documented case I know about, but I guess there's a couple of more. And I think we should be very careful. And I bring this forward because usually the other side argues with like one or a handful of cases about what these great capabilities have enabled them to. And when you ask about specifics, it boils down to, oh, that was at most one right before Congress, for instance, in the US recently. So just a little bit of thought for you.
Very illuminating, thank you.
Hi, not as much a pro or anti question, but more of a objective question. What about the oops, I lost my key argument? Suppose a suspect would be required by law to disclose the decryption key because he's under suspicion. And the suspect says, oh, sorry, I forgot the key, or I lost the key, in case he wrote it down. There are two possibilities. Either the suspect is lying and using it as an excuse, or could actually equally be possible, the suspect actually did lose the key. What effect would that have with regards to the burden of proof? How would that work?
Happens to me all the time. So who are you asking the question?
Both.
Both. Merel, maybe?
Okay, I'll start. Well, again, it's the burden of proof. So I think it will boil down to this question. Will the police be convinced that you have actually forgotten your password, or will they think that you are just not willing to say it? If the latter is the case, you will go to jail. If the first one is the case, there will be no problem, or not at least not such a big problem anyway.
There is certain jurisprudence on cases where somebody should have information, but he claimed that he forgot it, and there was still a verdict, and he was proven guilty. So there are cases in which, oops, I forgot it, was not accepted by the judge. And this part is also in the research of Copes that I referred to earlier. He goes into this argument quite extensively there.
So what if you actually did lose the key? How can you defend yourself?
That it's quite problematic.
I have my passwords in a PGP encrypted file. If I lose a file, I'm fucked when the police would be on my doorstep. The same goes for my ATM card. I have a four-digit number, which is like in memory. I remember this because of typing it. But if the numeric keyboard is the other way around, then I will mistype it all the time. Even when I'm stressed sometimes and I'm trying to get some money out of the wall, I forgot about the code. And then, yeah, that would be a problem.
Yeah.
So there will be a lot of readers for Bertjard Koop's...
I want to make
very
a more...
Good.
How much time do we...
We have a little bit longer because the next speaker is delayed. So do you want to comment now or do you want to have the question?
Let's have the question.
Let's have the question.
I have another last question, more than a remark. I am, among many other things, also a member of Chaos Computer Club. And it seems to be that the points I was making early on seems to be some kind of consensus inside of CCC. So we use our own events to organize and actively fight political choices which we think are wrong. Now, outside of this tent is a company which co-founder and director is actively publicly advocating for cyber armies and actively attacking computer systems online. And if you disagree with that, you probably should tell them.
Sorry, you probably should what?
Tell them. Oh, tell them.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
A small follow-up question on the decryption order question. What if I steal your laptop? I install a decrypted partition on it, I give it back to you, and then I call the cops that guy has child pornography on his computer, and you get a decryption order. But you never encrypted your disk.
But will you be all on the circumstances of the case, to which extent there can be forensics on that a computer was actually stolen and this was put on by somebody else, etc. It's very delicate in that sense that it's not just the fact that the container is there and you don't know the key. Yeah. It's the whole case, and I'm absolutely not in favor of the decryption order. I'm against it. So it's a very valid point that you are making. And it can be a problem. Yeah.
Thanks.
Next question.
Nobody has made a comment so far about handling stolen data. I just want to say that the Dutch tax service is doing this all the time.
Thank you.
About that decryption thing, one thing I've just realized is that you should, if this comes law,
we should all check our computer for encrypted files that we may have lost our passwords for, because if you ever get arrested and there's some old file from years ago that you haven't got a clue what it was and what the password was, you're almost automatically guilty.
Is this true?
So I think, this is true, because I think this is also one reason. We had, before we had this, it was a remark that if you have spyware that needs to be, or remotely accessed computers by the police, you need to have vulnerabilities to enable the police to really get into the computer. So it lowers the security of our society. The same goes for the decryption order. If we all are taking a risk by having encrypted files on your computer where you've forgotten your the password for, then probably you will do less encryption. And I think so this decryption order will only make us less safe than safer.
Yeah. Thank you.
Hi. A concern of mine concerning this is the sovereignty of this different states. So you argue that this measure is necessary in the case that we don't really know where this criminal is located. Well, how can you prove that the person is based in the Netherlands when you are going to actively, offensively attack their system? If you can prove that they are in the Netherlands, then why can't you just do it the traditional way where you get a warrant and actually physically go to that machine? Mm-hmm. Is just the police being lazy or...?
Thank you.
Very good point. That's one of the problematic aspects of this proposal. And what you see, how the government dealt with that aspect, is say, okay, there's a principle of territoriality. That means that you have the power to enforce your law on a certain territory. And this principle doesn't go online. It doesn't work like that. So we just don't use it. And then they make a remark lower to it, and they say, and in case we do know where the suspect is or where the server is located, that doesn't necessarily have to say that we use traditional methods. We can still use this new hacking authority. So, and that is very problematic, but. Also, from a legal perspective, because this territoriality principle doesn't go only for the fact that you you enforce your criminal laws and you can go behind go after crooks. It also goes for the fundamental rights protection. So it has two sides, territoriality and legality. So you can enforce your laws, but you also make sure there's enough protection and everything is proportionate and subsidiary. So all these measures are being taken. The moment you start enforcing your laws abroad, or anywhere around the world, that whole side of legality, that whole side of territoriality, the fundamental rights aspects, are not taken into account, and that's not well taken into account in this proposal. And that's highly problematic for the fundamental rights protection around the world.
And can I add to that?
Sure, briefly though.
Yeah, the Dutch government is proposing this these powers by saying we need this power because we sometimes don't know where a computer is. But one of the reasons for having this power, if you read the actual proposal, is just for being able to look inside a computer and see whether there is a reason for other powers to be introduced. So it doesn't really... So the government says it's for one reason, but there are many other reasons mm-hmm. the government wants to have this proposal accepted as well.
Question?
All right, it will mostly just be a quick remark, and that is that the realization of the person in the front row that you can't even have a single encrypted file on your disk, it also means you can't have any random data on your disk, and which happens pretty often, so I'm kind of confused now where the burden of proof is, because the point I was making previously is that this first law would say we suspect you of doing something wrong and we want you to encrypt your disk, which means they don't really have a real burden of proof because you need to decrypt it, but when they can't prove that you have several disks to encrypt, so they can't prove that you have multiple, then the burden of proof is again on them.
In a way, it's the kitchen knife. Everybody has a kitchen knife, but it can be used for murder, so there is random data. But does that random data mean that there is an encrypted file with certain illegal material on there? That depends on the other circumstances, I would think. Or wasn't that your question?
Well, what kind of circumstances?
Well, that's a case-by-case assessment.
So then the burden of proof is not really on them. So it's going to be cited by a person rather than just...
You said it was a brief comment.
All right, sorry.
So we have time for one more question, I'm afraid. Sorry, Rob.
Okay, I wanted to comment on your answer to the previous question. If I understand correctly, you said that the reason the government wanted the hacking power was to, because it didn't know where the computer was. But if I read the explanation of the law correctly, it said that it wasn't so secretive about why it wanted it. It was because it wants to actively monitor the communications of criminals and wants to, for example, with full disencryption, wants to see the encryption keys while being in memory. They weren't very secretive about that, and I heard you say that.
I'm not saying they are secretive about it, but I'm saying that if the government is explaining this law in the media, for example, they will. The first point they're going to make is they're going to say it is needed to have these powers because we do not always, we are not able to always determine where the computer actually is located. But there are many other ways, and they are, of course, it's in a provision in the law, so everyone can read it. But if they are gonna, if they're gonna explain this to the general public, that's the first point they make.
All right. Yeah.
Thank you very much. So I would like to wrap up this panel by doing a really short poll. So we had four items in this Dutch proposal. One was giving hacking powers to the government. I would like to ask everybody who is in favor of this proposal in some way or moderately in favor to raise their hands. Okay, so we do have some people in favor. Who's opposed to that part of the proposal? Okay, there's a few more, and then there's a couple without necessarily an opinion on this. The second one was removing the accessibility to certain types of information, either by deleting it or by just cutting down the access to it. Who's in favor of that? Just to give you an idea of how we stand in this community. Some maybe so. Who's opposed to that? Okay. Then we get the somewhat controversial issue of decryption orders. In favor, please raise your hands. So this is clear. This seems to be unanimous. Who's opposed? I should ask also. So it's basically most other people. And finally, we had the handling of stolen data. So this is punishable by law, according to this proposal. Who would be in favor of that? Okay, so a few hands. Who is opposed to that? Okay, so I'd like you all I'd like to thank you all very much for this for the stimulating questions. I'd like to thank the panelists Merel and Rejo very much for their open answers. And Ralph, we're going to go to the media cafe, so there will be time for further questions there. Thank you very much.